Hello, welcome to this Microsoft Virtual Academy session. This is part two of the session on user and device management. In part one, we covered off the setup and the initial experience of enrolling a device. In this session, we're going to go through the end user experience and application delivery. My name's Martin Booth. I'm a technical product manager. I work on the enterprise client team around user and device management solutions. And with me is Wally Mead.
Hi, I'm Wally Mead. I'm on the engineering team as a senior program manager working with the Windows Intune and Configuration Manager on-premise products.
So in the last session, I gave you an overview of the people-centric IT approach to management. I just wanted to give a brief recap around what we view as people-centric IT. We spoke about the four areas we have: the user with their desire for the device of their choice and working where they want, the plethora of devices out there and different platforms that we need to bring within the enterprise. I spoke about the application side of things and how we want to enable the users to get their applications in a simple manner, in a way that they're familiar with through an app store style approach. And then we mentioned briefly the data side of things. How do we make sure that the devices are in a state where they're well managed, that they're secured in a way that's appropriate with the compliance settings of the organization, so that we can ensure data on the devices is protected and kept from risk. I spoke a bit about the platform we provide, the management capabilities of System Center Configuration Manager with Windows Intune, and also a bit about how we get access to applications through the company portal. The three pillars we looked at were around enabling the users, so giving people the choice of which devices they want to use and how they can get consistent access to their company resources. We talked about unifying the environment, bringing together all the devices in one console where you've got the single view of both your on-premise management and your device management. And then we spoke about the data protection side of things, so helping make sure the devices are not at risk. So we're going to leap straight into demos in this section, and we're going to go through kind of the experience of setting up applications for delivery. Wally's going to walk us through the admin experience of how we actually set up an application for deployment, whether it's a web app or a line of business app. And then we're going to look at that experience for the end users on the device as well. So Wally, do you want to take us through the console?
Absolutely. Thank you, Martin. So in part one, we went through and we showed you the integration between the cloud service Windows Intune and the on-premise Configuration Manager product. And what we did there was just showed you how to set up the subscription, how to set up the Windows Intune connector, how to go ahead and enroll the two mobile devices that we had here, and then showed you a little bit of the inventory information. So more of the infrastructure side of things. Now what we're going to do is we're going to show you how to manage these devices once they're enrolled in your infrastructure. So we'll start with application deployment. So back in our console here, I'm in the software library. I've expanded application management, and I'm sitting in the application space. So in that space, this is where I go in and create applications for delivery to my devices or end users. So you can see we have a number of different applications already created here. And the interesting thing, and I'll walk you through this in a moment, if you look at some of these applications, that there's numerous different deployment types. Deployment types in this context would be looking at the platforms that these applications are applicable to. So you can see that the OneNote application has four different deployment types, and Skype has five different deployment types. If I want to easily see what those are, then I'll walk you through the creation process. I just take the application, let's say Skype, and then go down to the bottom and click in the preview pane, the deployment types tab. And then now we show you in the preview pane, we show you those five different deployment types. And you can see the technology or the platform that's supported here. So here you see it's a Windows Store application, a Windows Phone Store application, an application from the Google Play Store, and then a couple of apps for the App Store for iOS, for an iPad, and for an iPhone. So we show you right in your display, once you've created or imported an app that somebody else has created, or maybe you created, Martin, in the test lab environment and you'd want to recreate in production, you just export it and import it, you can very easily see what the configuration is. So it's very, very nice and easy for you to see what your existing apps are. But to create an app, it's a very simple process as well. You just go to the applications node, you can right click, say create application, our wizard will pop up, and we'll let you pick the type of application you want to create. And I'll just scroll all the way down the bottom, then I'll zoom in. And you see there's quite a different selection and plethora of different options available for types of apps that we can create and manage through our configuration manager environment. So specifically for the mobile platform we have, you would have these two up at the top, Windows App Package and Windows App Package in the Windows Store. Those would be applications that you would install onto a Windows 8.1 client or a Windows RT device, whether it's a sideloaded application or whether something you're going to get directly from the Windows Store. Down a little bit further, you see the two options for Windows Phone. So the same thing, a sideloaded application or a store application for a Windows Phone 8 device. Go down a little bit further, you'll see the two different options for iOS and the two different options for Android devices. Again, sideloading directly, like a line of business application you would purchase or create in-house, or an application you would get from the appropriate App Store or Google Play Store. So those are all specific to the mobile platforms that we have. And then at the very bottom, you'll see also another one we added in the R2 release of Configuration Manager 2012, which is a web application. Allows you to point your users to a URL for some web application you have, whether it's an expenses or time reporting or whatever it happens to be. So they just kick off the application and bingo, the website appears for them automatically. So let's just show you real quickly. So you'd go start an application, you'd pick the appropriate type of app you want to create, and then just browse to the source files for that application. So if I wanted to take a web application, I could take the very one at the very bottom, and I just specify, as it shows you here on the console, your syntax. You just go ahead and punch in a URL that you want to go ahead and browse to. So if I were to go ahead and type in http://ccrmcontoso.com, and now I've got a reference, a URL to my CRM application. Go ahead and click Next. It creates the application. I can go ahead and specify Contoso CRM application site, whatever properties I want to, go fill out this. A lot of it's administrative metadata. Some of it will appear in the portal for the end user. Click Next. My application is now being created. It'll be done in just a second. Now that I've got the app created, I can go ahead and specify any properties I want for it. You see it's got the one deployment type, which we're showing you down at the bottom is the web application deployment type. I can go ahead and go to the properties of this application. Once I've done that, I can go ahead and specify application catalog information that might appear. But what's important for me right now is go to deployment types. And here I can see my web application deployment type. This is where I get to go in there. When you had the applications with multiple different deployment types, I get to specify which platform that will be applicable for. I can put in requirement rules. So I go to the specific deployment type, click Edit, and then if I go to the Requirements tab, you see there's no requirements specified at all. So it's available to anybody that's targeted. Well, if I want to control who has access to this, I would click Add, and now I can go ahead and put in either device or user requirement rules, or I can create my own. Maybe I want to look at a registry key. Maybe I want to look at something in WMI on a Windows platform. I can go and create my own different types of requirements that I want to have. In this case, let's go to device. And we talked before about that device ownership. So now I can say ownership as a requirement rule. And this is a CRM application I only want to make available to corporate devices. So I'll change the device ownership from personal to company. And now, even if I deploy this application to all users in my environment, only if they're on a corporate-owned device would they be allowed to install this application. And you can put in multiple different requirement rules to meet whatever your needs. Maybe you want specific memory, maybe you want specific operating system versions, whatever it happens to be. I'll just put in that one, click OK. I've got my application created the way I want it. Now all I do is a deployment. So I just do a right-click and go deploy my application, just like you deploy a Windows installer application. So I picked a collection of users I want to go to, or computers, if it's a device-based application. So I go ahead and pick whatever I want, click OK, and I just walk through the rest of the deployment wizard and fill out my deployment process. So I get a control with my requirement rules, who gets to run the application, even though I might target everybody. So very, very simple, easy, consistent process. You're just picking an application that's appropriate for the platform you want to go ahead and target. So very, very easy, cool. Again, the workflow is all consistent with what you already know.
In terms of workflow, Wally, one thing we can do as well is require administrator approval for an application as well.
Yes.
Do you want to show us in the console where you would set that up? So if your user goes to request an app, they'll get prompted for a business justification, and the approval will have to be done on the back end. So where do we set that on that?
Yeah, so if I just go back, I'll just take this Contoso CRM application again. I'll deploy it to all users, all 140 of them. But again, it, requirement rule will only be if it's on a corporate device. There's no content to put on a DP since it's a URL. And I make this an installation. One of the cool things we now have with the R2 release is you can do an uninstall of applications for mobile devices as well. We had that previously for the on-premise devices. Now we have it for some of the mobile platforms as well. But I want to go ahead and do an install, and they can either be available or required now with R2 as well. Again, as we mentioned in part one, you probably only want to do the required on a company-owned device. But if I make this available, here's the checkbox you're asking about, require administrator approval if the users request this application. So the application will appear in their portal, the company portal, and when they try and install the app, they'll have to fill out a submission request. Why do they think they need this application? I need this because I work in the finance department, I have to do this, whatever it is. And that would go back to our administrator console. The administrator, appropriate administrator, would approve or deny that request. It would go back into the portal, and if approved, the end user would then be able to click the app and then click install.
So it's a very familiar workflow for the IT pro to set this up as if they were distributing an app for a PC that they're used to. So similar experience, same kind of wizards and functionality available where appropriate on the mobile platform.
Yeah, we tried to make it as common of a workflow so there's not a big learning curve going from the on-premise management they already know to managing these mobile devices they have now. Yeah, so very, very simple, easy thing to do.
Okay, so if our IT pros out there have applications that they've developed in-house that they want to send out to their mobile devices, do you want to show us how you would actually push out a sideloaded app to a device?
Sure. Let's go back to applications. We'll do a create application, and this will do a Windows modern application. And we'll go ahead and go to our demo. CM and our software. Just browse to your appropriate files and Windows 8. And we'll go to expenses. And then you just browse to the appropriate application file. In this case, because it's a Windows 8 or modern app, it's an .appx file. But notice in the R2 release, we're now supporting AppX bundles. Mm-hmm. So you'd have multiple different applications in a single bundle that you, in essence, zipped up and being able to pull those out of here as well. So you just browse to the appropriate application that you want, click Next, fill out the rest of the wizard as we saw before. So put in this case, it's my expenses, your publisher, appropriate categorization information you want. Notice something new that we've added in the R2 release as well. We'll talk about later on when we get into settings, is that for modern applications, you can go ahead and specify that when this app launches, if it needs network connectivity, have it automatically establish a VPN connection for me. Mm-hmm. So the end user doesn't have to go out there and manually establish the VPN connection back to CorpNet to be able to run this application. You can have the application do it for you automatically.
Great.
So very cool and easy to configure for the end for the administrator, and makes it obviously easy for the end user. So you just go through the process of creating the application, the wizard, just like I showed to the web app. And now you just take it and do the deployment process we showed you before.
Yeah. And exactly the same thing applies if you've got an iOS app you've developed and you've got the IPA file, you can deploy it in exactly the same manner out to the mobile devices.
Yep. And the other thing we have now is, as we kind of showed you before, is the ability of going to the stores. So we go, if I want to deploy an app to the iPad from the App Store, I just go ahead and specify that's the type I want. I click Browse. That'll go ahead and take me to, in this case, the iTunes store. And now I can go ahead and find the application I want to go ahead and make available to my end users.
So a great example of an iOS app that we've just come out with from Microsoft is the remote desktop client. The ability to have a VDI session, a remote desktop session from your iPad back to your Windows desktop. So why don't we go and find the remote desktop app here that we can then publish out to our users?
All right, that would be in the business category. And conveniently, starting with M for Microsoft. And you can notice there's a whole bunch of different pages here for M's. We do know this happens to be on page 15, so we'll just go browsing to page 15 directly, but you can do some searching for it. And then you go down to the Microsoft section, and there you see Microsoft Remote Desktop. So you find the Microsoft Remote Desktop application for your iOS devices. You can read all the information about it that's necessary for it, that you want to have. And then you just go ahead and click OK. And now you see that in our wizard to create the application, we publish basically the URL to this application in the iTunes store that will then, when we deploy this to the end user, this link is available to them. They click the install, and it takes them directly to the store. They go ahead and do the installation from the iTunes store, app store or so. So very easy, again, to do not only sideloading of line of business apps or things that created in-house, but also store-based applications for the end user. The nice thing with this store-based application deployment along with your line of business apps is the end user doesn't have to go searching the stores for the application. Mm-hmm. You've decided what you think is appropriate for them to install. You then publish it by deploying it as an application to them. They go to our portal, the company portal. They find the appropriate applications there. They don't know whether it's a side-loaded app or whether it's a store-based app. They pick the app. Yeah, I want that one. And if it's a store-based app, we take them directly to that app in the store. And they just sign in, and they are able to install directly from the store. So no browsing, no searching for the end user. Mm-hmm. We make it nice and simple for them.
Great.
Yep, so very, very easy to go ahead and do that as well. So just go create whatever type of apps you want that you need to deploy depending upon the platform that you want to go ahead and deploy your apps to. So very, very simple, easy process, consistent workflow.
Great. So we've seen the IT pro side of things and how you can take an application and deploy it, how you can add web applications as links within the company portal, and the sideloading of apps. So the three app types across all four platforms that we support there. So let's switch over to the devices and look at the end user experience of the company portal then.
All right, we'll start with the Surface device. So here's our Surface device that we have. And you'll see that it's loaded the company portal. So the company portal is the one-stop shop for the end user where they go to find all their information. So just if you start at the very beginning, it shows you your applications. So you can click on new apps, you can see browsing by categories, you can see the popular apps that you might have available to you. We'll get those in just a minute. If you scroll off to the right a little bit, you'll see your devices. Kind of like we showed you in the company portal for the iPad when we enrolled it, you can see your devices here. From there, you can go ahead and click on the device and you'll see the basic information on it. Something we'll show you later on in this session is the ability of retiring or wiping a device. And you can see the action here, to remove. A remove of that device would be basically unenrolling it, what we call a selective wipe. Mm-hmm. Just remove the company managed information and application on the device, but leave all my personal stuff there. The bottom option, factory reset, if the platform supports it, then that will do a factory reset, wipe everything out. Yeah, so more like the device has been compromised, got lost at the airport, or it got stolen. Mm-hmm. So you can go ahead and do the factory reset there. So you have that control here as well on your different devices. And then, of course, the company contact information if you happen to need support for your application. So you just go ahead and look at your application, browsing by categories, if there's any categories set up. Session is timed out. So we'll go ahead and do a log back in. And we'll see if I can type in a password properly this time.
And again, this is the corporate credentials. We're using Active Directory Federation services so that the corporate ID is being used to authenticate. It's not a separate ID, a cloud ID that we have. ADFS enables the corporate use of ID.
Right. So log back in, and there you can see the different categories, so one for communication, one for line of business apps, one for productivity. Just pick the appropriate category, and if there's any apps available, they would appear here. And you can always hit the back button and go back to your main corporate page for your app. So this is the company portal. We have it available for all of our platforms. You have it available, obviously, for the Surface device here. We saw it on the iPad. We'll go look at it again in just a moment. You have a version for Windows Phone 8, and you have a version for Android that'll be coming out when we have the Android support coming up.
And these company portals for Windows, for iPad, and the Android one when it comes along, they're available from the public stores, correct?
Yes.
But the Windows Phone one actually gets installed as part of enrollment.
Right. So when you take your Windows Phone 8 and you enroll it, we, as you saw when we did the subscription properties earlier, we had to specify the Windows Phone 8 company portal. That gets installed automatically as part of the process. The other ones, you go to the public store and you download the app from the apps iTunes store or Google Play store. And you can go ahead and then use that to enroll your device like we did with the iPad earlier.
Yeah, so a subtle difference in the way the app is deployed, the way the user gets the company portal. But once they've got that, it's a consistent experience regardless of which platform they're using.
Yep, makes it nice and easy. Now we should switch over to our iPad and look at the company portal on the iPad.
Great.
All right, so here's our iPad interface, the company portal that we saw earlier when we were doing the registration. You can see the device is registered because it does not have the exclamation point above MBOOSUM iPad again like we had earlier. And it shows you the other couple of devices we have enrolled. So very much a common look and feel with the Surface version of the company portal that we saw. You have the new apps, you have browse by category, so you can click on one of these and we'll show you that here's productivity or here's communication, and you'll see the appropriate applications you have available to you. So it's very, very common look and feel. I've got the contact information down at the bottom of the screen if I need any help on anything. Below my apps, the new apps and the browse by category and my apps, it shows me some applications here which are basically deep links or web-based apps. So here's a Contoso homepage application. So if I were to go ahead and click that, it would go ahead and launch off and allow me to go ahead and install this application, which basically is going to be install the URL for the homepage for Contoso here and launch that off. But it shows me my deep link or my store-based applications here as well as my web-based apps.
So do you want to go into one of those apps and show how you get through to the store?
Sure. If I click on Skype, you'll see that it is an application. It has a launch. So if I then click on launch, it takes me to the iTunes store directly to the Skype application. I didn't have to go in there and search for Skype. I, as the IT admin, had gone ahead and said, we want Skype available to all our users. I then deployed that as an application. The end user logs into the device, finds it. We take them directly to the store, and they would go ahead and click install from the store and go ahead and get the application installed from there. So very, very simple, easy process to get back to the environment that they were sitting in and where they want to be. So very, very nice and consistent process. And you have the same thing if you go to your device. Here you can see the ability of resetting the device or removing the device, even renaming it, which is just in the local portal here for my device. So again, common look and feel, common interface for the store-based applications. End user doesn't know. They click it off and, hey, I have to go to the store, and logs them in and away they go.
Great. So we've looked at the application delivery, both from the IT pro side of things and from the end user experience. The other big area is around compliance. How do we make sure these devices have the right appropriate security settings on them, the right configuration for my company? So do you want to take us through kind of where we set that up as the admin in the console?
Sure. So the last thing on the application stuff you would do is just the final piece of that would just go to monitoring, and you just go to deployments. And what you would see in deployments is the status of your applications that you've deployed. So here you can see just in our dashboard, you can see that this application is that I've highlighted is 50% compliant. Here's 62.5% compliant. You'll see your mobile device deployments, the exact same place, the exact same type of interface and status that you would see for your on-premise devices. So again, the workflow for the administrator, the IP pro, he knows exactly what he's doing and he can track those. And all these, as you mentioned before, will all appear in the normal reports. Mm-hmm. So I can go run a deployment report and I'll see the iOS devices versus the iPads versus the RT devices, whatever I've deployed to and users, I'll see all those tracked in the same way. So now for compliance. So compliance, you go back to the assets and compliance workspace and we'll go down to the compliance settings folder. And here's a number of different things we'll be able to set in compliance settings. I'll expand one more down and then we'll scroll down and I'll give you a real quick highlight of all these. Got a lot of different options here available to you. Configuration items is the traditional stuff that we've had around for quite a while now in various versions of Configuration Manager. Let me go and set an individual attribute that I want to change or query on a device to see if I'm compliant or not. And I'll walk you through that. So you create configuration items, you put them in a baseline, you deploy the baseline to the computer or to the end user. The new stuff we've added in R2 specifically for the mobile devices gets down here to the company resource access. And that's the ability of doing certificate management, creating those VPN profiles like we showed you for the web app earlier, the iOS app, and then Wi-Fi profiles. And I'll walk you through those. But let's start with the stuff that people somewhat already know. That's configuration items. So go to configuration items. We have none by default. Let's go ahead and create a configuration item. And we'll say we're going to disable FaceTime. Oops, we're going to go back and retype it properly. We're going to disable FaceTime because we don't want to have FaceTime people chatting off their iOS devices during work time. So you can create Windows type devices settings. You can do mobile device, which is what we want, or Mac OS X we support as well. So we'll go ahead and do mobile device. Click next. And you can see we have quite a number of different settings, groups, or categories that are available to us. And if I know exactly what setting group that my setting is I want to enable, I can go ahead and pick that, for example, password. If I know I want to set some password settings, I can go in there and click password. I go and say, yes, I want to make this required, and my password has to be at least 4 characters. It expires the next number of days, and so on. I can go configure what I want if I know the setting group I want. If I don't, oops, I went a little bit too far back. So let's try that again, disable FaceTime. Luckily, it's not hard to recreate, just hard to type properly. And go back here. Now, if I don't know what settings group my setting is in, I can select this bottom checkbox that says configure additional settings that are not in the default settings groups. I don't know where it's at. Just give me a flat listing of everything that's available to me and let me figure it out from there. So I'll go ahead and do that. Click next. There's nothing available. I want to add one. So I'll add. And now we give you a full listing of all the different settings. We show you what group it's in. So later on, if I want to go back there and specifically take that and create a new configuration item, I know what group to go to. We show you the platforms it's supported on and whether they're built-in settings or things I've created on my own. So FaceTime happens to be video chat client. So if you look at video chat client, you see that that's the name of it. It's in the device group. So now I know I can go back to the device group, select it, and video chat client will appear there. And you can see it's applicable to iOS devices. Not available to anything else. Nobody else has FaceTime. So we'll take that one. Maybe I also want to go ahead and go up here and say autofill browser, allow autofill in browser. So you see this is available to iOS and Windows 8.1. This would be, as you know, when you go and type in a URL, we try and fill in automatically for you. But we've seen cases where people have been hit by a phishing site, and all of a sudden they were going to a site that it autofilled that phishing site, so they got, again, another
keep
virus.
Keep falling back in the trap.
Correct. We keep falling back into that trap. So this will go ahead and disable that. Let's go ahead and select that option. And I want to say I want to disable this. So I want to allow autofill. I want to say false. I don't want to allow that. And the important thing here would be remediate. Remediate means if we're not set to this value, in this case false, make it, enforce it on that device. So I'll go ahead and enable that one.
So if that wasn't checked, this would just pull back a report, a value for that
a compliance,
setting.
Let me know who and has it enabled and who doesn't. Yes. But I want to change it. Let's go back and do our FaceTime. We'll select that one. And I'll do the same thing. I want to turn off FaceTime. And again, the same checkbox for remediate means enforce it. Don't just tell me the compliance level of it. So I'll take those two values. I've got those selected. I can see them here. Tells me I've got them both set to false and I'm remediating yes. I would click next. Now we show you all the different platforms. What platforms do you want to allow to try to implement this setting? And we showed you back in that previous dialogue that it was only applicable to iOS or iOS and Windows 8.1. But I don't have to know that. I don't really have to care about that. I can say I want to select all these different platforms. And even though I know they're not all applicable to all these platforms, when I click the next button, we'll go in there and we'll figure it out for you. We'll say, okay, Wally, you said you wanted to disable video client chat for all these platforms, but it's only applicable for iOS. So we'll go through and we'll tell you what platforms this is not going to be implemented on. Mm-hmm. The value here is that I don't have to create separate settings just for iOS, separate settings for Windows 8.1, separate settings for my Windows Phone 8 devices. I can have one compliance setting baseline that has all the different options for all the different platforms I want, target all of them, and we'll do the end result for you. We'll figure it out. We'll only apply what's applicable for you.
So the IT pro no longer needs to think about creating device-specific settings packages, but now can think about the actual features and functionality that they're dealing with the settings, and then just package that up, and they'll get a report at the end that says, hey, this is what's going to apply, and this is what it won't apply.
Right. In fact, even here, you can see there's an export report. I can do an export report, but then it'll let me do a CSV file that will dump out this listing for me so I know where these aren't going to be applied. So I have that report, or I can wait for the normal compliance evaluation on the device, comes back in, gets summarized, run a normal configuration manager report. Yes. So go ahead and create that. Now, as a configuration item, what I would do is then I have to then add that to a baseline. So then I'll go ahead and create a baseline. We'll just call it MVA demo, and we'll do an add. We're going to add configuration items, and I only have one. It says disable FaceTime, but it had those two settings in there I had added in. We'll add that. Click OK. Click OK. I've created my baseline. The last thing I do is I go ahead and deploy my baseline. Very much like we looked at deploying apps, I just do a deploy of my baseline, and it shows me my configuration baseline I'm going to deploy. MVA demo, I could, if I had multiple, I could deploy them all at the same time. Now, the important thing here, if we want to enforce those settings, is I have to check this checkbox. So I have to say, yes, I want to go ahead and do remediation of the baseline. If I just have remediation on the configuration item, but not in the baseline, it's not going to enforce it. It's just going to come back and tell me compliance level. Am I compliant with my setting of disabled for those two settings or not? So I have to do both in the CI as well as baseline. So the nice thing is I can prepare these for enforcement on my clients, but right now, if I don't select this checkbox, I'll just be a investigation stage. Let me see how in bad a shape I am. Then, okay, I really do need to enforce this. So I go back here and just select a checkbox and we're off and running.
And again, this is the same kind of workflow as if you were doing on-premise PC management.
Absolutely. I'm looking at a different platform and different settings. And then just, I don't have maintenance windows for my mobile platforms. If I did have for the Windows, I could go ahead and do that. I can generate alert if I'm not 90% compliant in 2 days. Generate an in-console alert, which could be email subscription, and let me know that. And then who am I targeting this to? I want to go ahead and target this to, I want to do devices, all my iOS devices, or all my mobile systems. I can go ahead and target that, and then I would just go ahead and do a deployment, and bingo, those are off and running. That'll get pushed up through the Windows Intune connector to the Windows Intune service. Next time the clients go and do their polling of policies, they'll find those and they'll go ahead and implement those locally, report back status through the Windows Intune connector again back to us, and it will appear in the console as well as in all our reports.
Great. And you mentioned the company resource access policies. Do you want to take us through what's new in those?
Yeah. So we have the ability of creating certificates and managing certificates. So here I can create a certificate profile, and you can go ahead and create your certificate. It can be either a trusted CA, like a Microsoft Certificate Authority, or you could use the SCEP protocol, the Simple Certificate Enrollment Protocol settings, if you have Windows Server 2012 R2 with the appropriate role installed in Windows Server. So you can go ahead and specify the certificates you want. So you'd have the certificate created either in the SCEP protocol or in our CA, import it here, and specify how you want that sent out to your clients.
So if I've got a web application I'm using and I've got my own certificate authority, I can use this to take that root certificate and push it out to all my mobile devices so they trust that application's cert authority. Right. Or if I'm using certificates for, let's say, user authentication for something, I can use the SCEP protocol with this to actually initiate that enrollment of the user certificate.
Yep. So it's very nice. We let you manage your certificates through the Configuration Manager 2012 R2 process going down to the clients as well. VPN profiles. So VPN profiles, there's a couple of them created here that we'll look at in a moment. Let me just walk you through the creation process. So I want to go ahead and create a profile for Contoso Corp. If I already had this exported out to a file, I could just import it. I don't, so I'll just walk through the wizard. And I specify the different vendor of the VPN I have. So it's not just Microsoft VPN solutions, it's all the leading industry manufacturers of VPN. So you pick and choose whatever your corporation already has in place. So you go ahead and specify that. I'll go ahead and just take the easy one to fill in. And you go in there and specify any settings. So here I want to say this is Contoso VPN and my address of my server is... Go ahead and punch that in, and then my DNS suffix, contoso.com. I specify what my authentication method is. We got to get in all the different various methods you have. You can specify whether you want to have users have to resupply their credentials or remember them. What are you doing for proxy settings? Do you have to specify a script? Do you have to specify a proxy server? Do you want to automatically detect your proxy configuration? Enable VPN on demand. So we talked about the application VPN earlier when we created the application. This is the ability of having a VPN created whenever you have traffic that's going to a specific DNS suffix. And then specify your DNS server, 192.168.3.5. And now anytime I have traffic to that, that server, to that DNS suffix, it's going to go ahead and automatically establish this VPN connection for Contoso Corp. And then again, specify the platforms you're supporting this on. So if we want to go ahead and support this on our Windows RT8.1 that we had and our iOS iPad we had, your iOS 7, but I'll pick 6 as well. And then the summary. Now, with the VPN profile, same thing for Wi-Fi profiles and certificate profiles, I don't have to add them to a baseline like I had two configuration items. I just take the Contoso Corp, I go ahead and right-click it, and then do a deploy, and then it looks very much like the deploying of the baseline for my configuration baseline. Just specify my target collection, all my enrolled users, if I want to generate alert, and how often do we want to go ahead and have this profile, profile or setting, baseline, whatever it is, reevaluated to make sure we're still within our corporate compliance. Just go ahead and configure those, and you're off and deploying. And then just a matter of who gets targeted with which platform you're supporting and which group you're targeting, which collection, as to which one of these profiles they would get. Same basic thing in Wi-Fi profiles. So we have one for corporate Wi-Fi. You saw the process of creating the VPN one, so it's very similar here. Just to show you what's already created there now. Wi-Fi profile, looking for the network name and the SSID, automatically connect. You can say, oh, even if it's not broadcasting, go and automatically connect if you want to. Security configuration, we're open. Probably not what we want to have, but we want to have some web enterprise settings, advanced settings, if there are any, for the appropriate security configuration you have. What are you going to do for proxy settings? Do you have to configure a proxy for that? And then again, what platforms you're supporting. So you go ahead and configure your Wi-Fi configuration as a profile. Once you've done that, you then just go ahead and deploy it. And here it says it's deployed. Just the verification, you go down to the Deployments tab in the preview pane, and you see this case, it is deployed to all users again.
Okay, great. And this means that when, as an end user, I take my device and enroll it, as well as getting the management and the policy come down, I get these settings provisioned to my device. So I don't have to worry about how do I set up the Wi-Fi network, how do I set up VPN, how do I go and get certificates for my device. It'll all just come down as part of that enrollment.
As long as your IT pro, your admin, has done all that provisioning for you, it's easy. Like you say, you enroll your device, you get everything that's been provisioned to you. So you're off the hook for most of the hard stuff as an end user. Yes, and then you can see the compliance level here. We're 15.1% compliant, and we're in an action of remediate. So we're going to remediate this Wi-Fi profile on the targeted users, in this case for the collection.
Great. So it's very easy to create compliance items that are done in a manner that's similar to the PC compliance items and give the end user great value by pre-configuring certain things on their device for them so that when they walk into their corporate environment, it's ready to go with things like Wi-Fi and certificates. That's great.
And the other settings, like you're talking about in your intro, I want to protect my corporate data, my corporate environment, so I can go then lock down cameras. And if I'm in a manufacturing area where it's very sensitive, I don't want to have people cameras enabled. Mm-hmm. I can turn those off. I can ensure password policies on my devices. I can lock these down to what I need for my corporate standards, so I feel secure as the IT side of the house, but still giving the end user all those different benefits that you mentioned as far as flexibility in their device and getting all their applications and accessing all their corporate data.
Yeah, and also in terms of ensuring the right apps are going to devices that are secured in an appropriate manner, you've got the targeting and you've got the compliance reporting on the other end. So you can tie those two together and work out, okay, my environment is what I expect it to be, is well managed, and my apps are going out to devices that I trust and know are compliant.
And you have the in-console dashboards as well as reports to validate what your status is as far as your compliance in your infrastructure.
Great. So what happens when I've got a device that I no longer want to use for corporate stuff? I've got my iPad. It's great for some personal stuff, but I'm going to hand it off to the kids because I've got my Surface now, which is just far more useful for work. So what do I do with my iPad now it's enrolled and managed and got my corporate stuff on it?
Okay, there's two different ways to unenroll a device, a couple different ways. So from the admin console side of the house, you just go to your devices and, I need to find Martin's device. Let's go maybe up to users and I can go and search for Martin. And I search for Martin, there you are. and I want to see all your primary devices, so I can go ahead and just click primary device, and that shows me your devices that you have enrolled in your environment that have registered at this point in time we had it. And I want to get rid of one of these. All I can do is I just right-click that device, and then I can, you have an option down here for retire or wipe. Retire slash wipe, and then we'll show you what option is available on that device depending upon the type of device it is. So there's two different options here. Wipe company content and retire the mobile device from Configuration Manager. That's what we call selective wipe. Get rid of all the stuff that we provision through Configuration Manager and Windows Intune on that device, but leave all my photos, my contacts, my personal music and stuff that I have on the device. The other option, if it's available to you, is wipe the device and retire it. So wipe it is a factory reset. Mm-hmm. Clean it out, and that's more the scenario you talked about as a top one. Do the selective wipe, let me clean off the management stuff so I can have a clean device to give to my kids. The bottom one is, I left this in TSA at the airport and I forgot it, and it's gone now. I'm not gonna get it back, so I wanna make sure it's all cleaned off, so I do the full wipe. So it depends upon the platform and where you're initiating the action from, what you have available to you. But you have those type of actions available. If I just go back to here, and let's go back. I guess I could have picked anybody's iPad there, but pick an iPad and do a retire wipe. And here you see the iPad supports both a selective wipe and a full wipe, where the Surface doesn't, only does selective wipe. So you can pick and choose what you want to have available to you. So this is from the admin console side of the house. Mm-hmm. I can go ahead and choose that and control that if I know. So if you were knew that you were going to get rid of the device, you could tell me and I could go ahead and do the selective wipe for you. Or you come back and tell me, Wally, I lost my iPad. I can go ahead and do the full wipe for you. Now, you could also control this on your own from the company portal on your device. So if you go back to the iPad, remember we showed you this before, if you just go to, in the company portal, you click on the appropriate device you want to interact with, you have the reset device, you have the remove device. So the remove device would be the unenroll. So remove it from management, do the selective wipe, get rid of all the company stuff, and leave all the other personal stuff for me to hand off to my kids. The reset device would be the full factory reset, wipe it. Probably wouldn't do that from the portal, because I, like I say, I want to hand this off to one of my kids. But you have that. In the Windows RT case that I showed you how to enroll, remember I did the turn on, to turn on management, to enroll it? I just clicked the button that's now labeled turn off. So do turn off, that unenrolls it from management, from the device. So if I still have the device, I want to do the selective wipe, I can go to the company portal and do that. I can do that from the RT device as well. Or how I enrolled it, I could unenroll it the exact same way. So from the portal or from the admin console side of the house, I can control that and look at the status.
So both the end user has control over it and the IT pro has control over it if they need to as well.
Right.
So again, ensuring company data is secured, protected. It's not going wandering about on devices that are being handed off or people who leave the company.
Right. Like
that.
Company portal, if you still have it, the end user, you still have the device, you can go ahead and control it on your own. If you don't have, then you let the IT admin know and he takes care of it for you.
Okay, great. Well, that was an excellent walkthrough. Thanks, Wally. That took us through the application side of things, compliance, the company portal experience. So between these two sessions, we've covered off the setup and the configuration and hopefully shown how easy it is to bring these devices into management in your enterprise alongside your existing PC management. So again, I want to show you some of the resources we have out there. If you want to go and get more information, check out the links on Microsoft.com. As I mentioned before, there are the evaluation version of System Center Configuration Manager R2 available, and you can sign up for a trial Windows Intune account. So if you want to go and try this functionality out in a lab environment, you can do.
We also have the evaluation VHD is published now as well.
Excellent. Well, that's some breaking news there. I didn't realize the VHD was out.
Yes.
But yes, so if you want to get down a virtual machine that's already pre-configured and ready to go, do go and check that out. Also, look at the other resources available from the Microsoft Virtual Academy. These sessions were part of the MVA series. There are many other resources out there that will take you through a lot of the Microsoft technologies, in particular the new releases around Windows Server R2 and the Windows 8.1 capabilities. So go and check out the Microsoft Virtual Academy link. So I'd like to thank you for watching this session. I'd like to thank Wally for taking us through
the
demos.
Mark.
I hope you enjoyed this session. I hope it was valuable to you. Thank you.